Marriage, love, meditation, and ego. Today I will focus on the point ego. When sex energy is stored at the base center, it is in solid form. Solid form means it is one of the form of the energy. Water is energy, ice is the solid form. Then anger, hatred, jealousy, all these remain as the quality of the person. These are all attendants of ego, or we call it nafs. It starts from there because of the energy not being in the liquid form, not moving. We become very rigid and uncompromising at times. It is one of the most fundamental problems man has to face. And in all the religions, all the paths, emphasis has been given to understand its nature. It gives you a false impression that something exists, but it is not. And it becomes one of the greatest problems. The ways of the ego have to be understood rightly, otherwise you will never be able to get rid of it. And until you get rid of ego, there is no possibility for flowering to happen in you. It is the ego that functions as a barrier between you and the reality. Ego functions as a barrier because it is one of the most unreal things possible. Ego is fiction. It is not a reality. It is maintained by conditionings. It is maintained by conditionings. Sufis have given a lot of importance on this, and they have specified 7 stages of nafs. The word that is used in Sufi terminology for ego is nafs. There are many things like hypnosis and 1001 props. It is fiction because existence is, it does not really exist. It can only have one center, not millions of centers. Sufism seeks to transform ego, and in Sufism it is known as nafs. Remember, Sufism is an alchemy, science to transform lead into gold, the baser into higher, and outer into inner. It is the science to transform the world into God. Remember, Sufism is not a philosophy or a speculation. It believes in experience instead of logical thinking. It works through experimentation. Only experiment can decide what is true. Remember, nothing else can be decisive. Only when you know, you really know, and there is no other way. There are 7 stages or 7 types of nafs, but it is better to understand these as stages. The first is commanding self or nafs amara. The second is the blaming self or nafs lavama. And then comes the third, the inspired self or nafs mulima. Fourth is satisfied self or nafs mutmainam. Fifth, consenting self or nafs radia. Then consent given self or nafs mardia. And the last is purified self or nafs safia. Sufi methodology centers of nafs 3 things, that is, they forms the trinity of Sufism: nafs, kalb, and ruh. Nafs refers to the lower emotions. First of all, when the energy is centered in the base center, it is in a solid form. Many negativities get around and it becomes very difficult to deal with such a person. The anger, hatred, love, jealousy, all these remain. When these begin to, the energy begins to melt and it begins to move to the other center, then the form of nafs changes and all these lower emotions, the seat of these is solar plexus. So that is why when we have any emotional trauma or disturbance, we get the problem in our solar plexus or stomach. And a common term is used that I cannot stomach it anymore. So for that reason, there are certain techniques that are used, hammering the solar plexus so that the energy begins to move from there. Nafs operates through consciousness or ego. Sufis say that there are 7 stages of consciousness or levels of self, nafs or ego. Kalb refers to the heart center. It is the seat of positive emotions. When hatred is transformed, it becomes love, and so on and so forth. When individual consciousness moves from lower rungs and is freed of ego, it moves from negative to positive state. Still journey continues. Last is the root. When an aspirant operates from any of these levels, it becomes the plane of operation. Normally, in the beginning, we operate through the ego center. And when the energy, the fruition happens, flowering has attained, energy reaches to the higher center, then one reaches to the center of Ru and operates from there. Also, for transformation of the aspirant, the shake begins from the plane from where the aspirant is operating from. For this, the master uses the technique of that particular plane, the methodology to evolve from any particular plane differs. First of all, when your energy is solidified, it needs to a certain amount of heat or work, which in terms of the yoga is called workout. We have to begin the workout. With that, a heat is generated in the body, the energy begins to melt. Then there are various stages through which one can move forward. So for this, the master uses the technique of the particular plane. If someone is at a particular plane, for instance, it happened once, a seeker came to Sufi Raghbar Dayal Razi Allah Ta'ala Unu and asked him to do some prayers. Now this does not form the part of prayers or anything. He said, when you go home in the evening at the dusk time, when sun is disappearing, you take a bath or you do wuzu, and then you light your incense, sit down in a comfortable corner, light your incense and cry. So he said, that's all I have to do. He said, yes, that's all you need to do. So first day he did what he was asked to do, but he was a sincere person because the master had asked, so he went to do that. The family, according to Hindus, crying at the dusk time is considered as a bad omen. So the family thought maybe he is remembering something of his family or the past or parents. That's why his emotions are hurt and he is crying. They overlooked it. Second day it happened, the same thing happened. When third day happened, they inquired, what is this going on? So he said, I am doing my prayers. You do your prayers your way, I do my prayers my way. But nobody understands that crying is a prayer. But it is a technique that the master has given him. So it happened that they went to the sheikh to inquire what kind of prayer he was given, that every evening at the dusk time, the man begins to cry and creates a bad omen. Luckily or unluckily, Sheikh Raghbar Dayal was not available at that moment. Instead, Sufi Ramchandra Zilla Talaunu was there. So he said that my father or whosoever it is was given this prayer. Every dusk time he cries for about half an hour to 45 minutes and creates a bad omen. It happens that if there is any such things, the other people feel is not a bad omen, they begin to feel uncomfortable. If you begin to laugh give a belly laugh, the other people will feel very uncomfortable and they call it as bad manners or this and that, different names they give it to it. But it happens that there it triggers off something in them and a fear arises in them. A process may begin in them as well. So Lalaji, that is Sufi Ramchand, immediately realized that it could be no one else except his younger brother who could give such a simple technique to move the seeker from one stage where he is stuck to the higher stage. His problem was his emotions were stuck, or you can say energy was stuck from a point. It has become solidified, or you can say it is stoic, stone-like he has become. When the grief is so much, sorrows is so much, then one is incapable of handling it. One becomes stone-like, immovable. Nothing creates any effect on that person. At that time, when you do purposely crying as a technique, then it clears off suppressed emotions. It forms the part of the catharsis. And when he did it, it was one of the simple techniques, but it is one of the most important technique of meditation. When you cry, your nasal congestion and emotional disturbance begins to disappear. And thereafter, so it is creating, first is clearing, then you need to do a laughter. And with the laughter, it creates a space in the solar plexus. And then when you go into a silence, it fills the emptiness with something which is of sublime nature. So these are some of the simple techniques that a master can give. So it happened that there Lalaji, Sufi Ramchand, inquired from his younger brother that did he give him this prayer. He said, yes, I had given him the prayer because his heart was too hard and nothing was happening. There's like a layers of it has become a stone like, and if you hammer it or send a strong energy, that can harm the person. So he was given this technique so that his suppressed emotions could be removed. Now for a modern man, we can devise some other techniques of meditation. For instance, you can use gym as a technique of meditation. When people are angry or they are upset with something, the anger is perpetuating within them, they go into the gym and do a workout. But this workout is unconsciously done. If it is consciously done, but with the workout, that energy begins to disappear from your system. After that, you need to enter into a same amount of if you are doing a workout for 45 minutes, for the same period of time, you have to enter into a silence. So that whatever the energy is transformed, it goes into your system in those areas where it is needed the most. Normally, the energy begins to move outward, and that too through the finger ends. That is the reason that when we sit down in meditation, we create a closed circuit so that energy does not. Hindus sit down, use three postures. They sit down either in an ordinary squatting position, or Padmasana, that is lotus posture, or half lotus posture. Muslims do not use this posture. They use a posture which in yoga known as Vajrasana, where the legs are folded under or bottoms, and then you sit down in that position. In yoga, this is known as Vajrasana. This is a good position when you want to have your food digested. But that, for that reason, make the fist of the two hands and put it on the either side of the solar plexus and remain there in that position for 10 minutes for food to be digested. But Muslims call this as dosanu posture. Christians kneel down. So in every system of meditation, there is a technique how one should sit in meditation. So when you are going through the workout in gym, this is the catharsis, and then if your ends of the nerves are open or loose ends, energy will move outward. But when they are in a closed circuit, the energy, instead of going outward, it will begin to move to those places where an emptiness or a space has been created. So it becomes very therapeutic. That is why for the transformation of the aspirant, the shake begins from the plane where the aspirant is operating from. For this, the master uses the technique of that particular plane, the methodology to evolve from a particular plane to another differs. The duality of the positive and negative continues until the aspirant crosses the plane of Ru, or what we call it the plane, the insight in yoga or in the field of Kundalini as the third eye center. Beyond that is the center plane of Ru. Beyond this, there is no duality. Parallel to this is found in the chakra or the psycho-spiritual centers, which I had mentioned yesterday. Two centers, the earth center and the water center, belong to the plane of nafs. The third center, which is solar plexus or Manipur, and the heart center belong to the plane of kal. And lastly, the throat center and the third eye center belong to the plane of Ru. Up to this plane, duality remains, and beyond this, all duality disappears. The duality is no more, and this is the most comprehensive explanation of nafs. Nafs operates through consciousness or ego. There are seven stages through which consciousness moves before it attains fruition. These are called the levels of nafs, levels of self or nafs, or states of self, states of nafs. But basically these denote the stages of consciousness. When consciousness takes shape in the beginning, it considers all the carnal desires as if they are its own desire. This is known as the desire nature that each individual is. At this level, it recognizes itself only as the physical body. Physical body have the sense of the organs of actions and organs of perception through which the information comes into you, and through organs of action you respond, you act to those impressions that comes into you. At this stage, ego operates as the commanding self. It commands itself, and it commands you when there is too much desires, anger, and desires are unfulfilled, anger comes, breeds in, and then anger takes hold of it. It becomes the commanding force, and everything operates through the filter of anger. Let us take one through the filter of anger. So the anger is the commanding. It is commanding the self, commanding the operation of the seeker. At this level of understanding, the consciousness recognizes itself as physical body alone. And physical body comprises of the organs of actions and organs of perception. First, what are the organs of perception? The eyes, ears, nose, skin, and tongue. Through these, through the tongue, taste comes in. Through eyes, form comes in. Through vocal cord, the sound. Through ears, the sound waves comes in. When these comes in, you have to respond to it. Sometimes you use your ends of the nerves, that is hands and the fingers, to express your emotions. So it is
known as the commanding self or nafs al-ammara. The body is recognized as the soul and the only entity. And at this level, the technique begins to be different. The second state of nafs is known as blaming the self or nafs lawwama. In the first state, the seeker associates himself with the body alone, nothing else matters. But in the second stage, it differs. While still he accepts himself as the body, he thinks that his life will never come to an end. The life of negativities will never come to an end. Also, it shall therefore go on in some way even after the body disappears, and that he will experience the consequence of his deeds in this world, and in that case the self begins to regret because he realizes his possible wrongdoings. While still considering future life after death, this state is described as blaming the self. So he begins to blame himself for all these things, or this state is known as nafs al-lawwama. Thereafter, the third stage comes inspired self or nafs al-mulima. The self at the both levels. In the first two stages, the focus remains on the physical body alone. The consciousness at that stage is not even aware of other stages, which is sama, and the world is the earth or the physical body, because the physical body is the only thing of which you are aware. So that remains the dominating factor. All his delights and his struggles are connected with this center, that is the body, or the earth element, or as we use the word earth in Sufi terminology. This you can observe, that this is the state of an individual as we see around. If consciousness realizes that it is not a fact, a body, but reflection of the universal consciousness, or an expression of the qualities possessed by the universal oneness, then at the level its capacity allows, an awareness that is called the inspired self or nafs mulima. A recognition has to come that I am not the body alone. I am something more than a body. Then you enter into this state. As one continues the journey, a point comes when one realizes I am not the body alone. There is something more than the body, and that's where you enter into the inspired self. Self begins to inspire, or you enter the state of nafs al-mulima. In view of its characterization, such awareness is realized through inspirations or ilhams alone. The company of the sheikh, or constant use of zikr, that helps him to come to move from one lower stages to the other. At that level of understanding, the consciousness begins to get rid of the idea of accepting himself as the body alone. You recognize that there is something more than the body. The awareness is very opaque, is not very clear as yet. Still, there are clouds around it. He sometimes feels himself as a body, and other times as something separate from the body. He is at the threshold. However, what kind of an entity he is at that state of feeling separate from the body and is not clear as yet. begins to see that something is in a hazy state. It is like when the dawn is coming, the darkness is beginning to disappear. Everything seems still unclear. The darkness is shedding, the light is descending slowly and slowly. So you try to focus, you try to look through a penetrating vision to see through. Also, that is not a state that can be experienced through knowing. From earlier on, the stage is the first two, the commanding self and the blaming the self. These two you can understand differently, but from here onwards you enter the realm of experience. So that is not the state that can be experienced through knowing. This stage of understanding for the consciousness is the most difficult stage of life. There the consciousness faces many contradictions. You may sometimes consider yourself as a servant. Other times you feel that you are God, experiencing the odd results of such sensations. The seeker who sees himself as God at that stage may even find the level of vilayat as lowering for him. He may thus let loose all the values and fall on a completely corporal life. So that stage is very difficult. A lot of care has to be taken so that one does not falter from that state and comes back to the ordinary corporal life. It normally happens when the seeker begins to move a little forward and he considers himself that he has attained a higher state of development. A fall comes in and he goes back to the old way of life. For seekers of true faith, the act of reading begins to be practiced at that level of consciousness. When reading the system that is called Sunnat Allah, he is initiated that time trying to understand the words of the masters, why and what, or why did the master said so. All these things become so. From Ilmul Yaqeen you are moving towards Haqqul Yaqeen. He begins to enter into deeper realms. He is purified from the spiritual powers of heartless discovery. He begins to perceive the secrets of the words of the scriptures. He experiences that spiritual state which is called as Arif. Almost all the persons whose belief assumes them to be in a simplified form, as the journey continues, the seeker goes through the various stages and the upward trend continues. The word nafs has two meanings. First, it means the power of anger and the sexual appetite in a human being, and this is the usage mostly found among the people who take nafs as the comprehensive word for all the evil attributes of the person. That is why I had mentioned that as such, when the existential energy exhibits from the earth center or the center, the base center, that time anger and the sexual appetite remains in the human beings, and when it is unfulfilled, many other It comes, many other things breeds in the human mind. Jealousy, frustration, hatred, so on and so forth. So it is, this energy has to move from there. This state has to move, and the seeker has to move to the second stage or the subsequent stages. So nafs is used as the comprehensive word for all the evil attributes of a person. That is why they say one must certainly do battle with ego and break it. You have to understand it first and then find the ways and means. You can fight with it, or you can understand it and then you will find the easy way to go through these stages. The second meaning of the nafs is soul. The human being in reality, his self and his person, however it is described differently according to different stages. If it assumes calmness after the command and has moved from itself the disturbance caused by the onslaught of passion, it is called the satisfied soul or nafs mutmaina. It is the first meaning of the nafs that does not envisage the return to God because it has kept itself far from Him. Such a nafs, it is said, it is the outcome of the negativities. However, when it does not attain calmness and yet sets itself against the love of passion and objects to it, it is called the accusing soul or nafs al-lawwama, because then it rebukes its owner for his neglect in the worship of his master. If it gives up all the protests and surrenders itself to the total obedience to the call of passion and devil or the negativities, it is called the soul that enjoins the negativities or nafs al-amara, and slowly through the path of technique of zikr or other techniques of meditation or the tawajjuh of the sheikh, the seeker passes through these various stages and reaches to the higher. First he moves from the energy which was in solidified form. I would use the simplest terminology to explain. The first is in a solid state, which is the state, three stages of water, the ice, water and vapors. So when it is in the ice form, it occupies a greater space, it remains there and slowly melts. When the heat is generated in the form of understanding, the one enters into male-female relation, then this energy begins to move, melt and becomes a liquid-like, and it begins to flow to the other center, just as water begins to flow from higher altitude to the lower. And then when it reaches the water center and begins to overflow, then at the center of the solar plexus of Manipur, which is the fire center, heat is generated in the form of you are doing the zikr, where you are hammering your solar plexus, then the heat is generated and this water begins to evaporate and it begins to move higher. Sufis say that human body is like a town and the intellect of the mature being is like the king that rules that town. All the forces of the external and internal senses that he can muster are like his soldiers and his aides. The ego that enjoins nafs amara, that is the negative aspect, that is lust and anger, is like an enemy that challenges him in his kingdom and strives to kill his people, the good qualities. The body thus becomes like a garrison town or the sea outpost, and the soul like its custodian posted in it. If he fights against his enemies and defeats them and compels them to do what he likes, then he will be praised when he returns to the higher realms. Sufi Brijmohan Lal continues the thought that still one's desire are of the kind of two kinds, praiseworthy, and that is called inspiration or ilham, and blameworthy, that is called whispering or vasava. The heart is owned mutually by the two forces, the positive and the negative. That is why it remains in a seesaw position. Sometimes it moves to this side and other times it moves to the next side. In traditional terminology, we use the word shaitan and angels. I call shaitan as the embodiment of negativities and angel as an embodiment of positive. These are the two dualistic forces. In life, when you see a simple situation comes, when you have to make a decision about, let's say you are thirsty and you want to drink something. You go to the shop to get something, and oh, someone who you ask that asked to get something to drink, the person puts the choices that these are the different drinks or different substances that are available, which one do you want? And it becomes very difficult to be precise, what do you want? This is a state of dualistic nature. What one can do, and when the situation like that comes, we have to recognize that we are using this particular drink or fluid in order to quench our thirst. It does not matter whether this or that. What it is necessary at that time, what is healthy for you. When I am traveling in the plane, the person asks, what do you want to drink? I said, you have to give me the choice. What is the choice that I have? He calls out the names. All the soft drinks and the juices that are available in the market, they have a high content of sugar, which is not beneficial to my health, and for that matter, anybody's health. So I will look into what else do you have. Juices that you get, they are not natural. They have the artificial flavors and sugar added to it. What else do you have? Do you have plain milk? Do you have water? I would go opt for that. So I am not inflicted by the duality. I am clear in my mind. What do I want? What does I need to provide to my body for its sustenance? And it is very important, this battle constantly goes on at the physical level. Physical level, for instance, your spouse asks for the physical relation, but there is a little anger in you for some matter, for over a trivial matter, you refuse that. Or you are indecisive whether to go into this or not. So this dualistic nature remains at the physical plane. You are thirsty, you are given an option of the two kind of drinks, both are harmful for you,
and it becomes very difficult for you to make a decision which one do you want. One has to be very clear at each stage that this is what I need. You are guided by the higher consciousness. Then at the emotional level, which is the second stage, so the angel emphasizes the positive attributes like bliss, bestowal of knowledge, and unveiling of truth, the promise of rewards, and ordering of the good. The negative stands for one whose business is to go against all that is positive. He propagates the ill will or vasava against ilham, against angels, and anything that is positive. Sometimes it does happen. We are in a negative mood and it becomes difficult for us to make the decisions. Here one thing needs to understand: the biorhythm chart. Sufis has emphasized that every individual goes through this cycle. The cycle of the physical, emotional, and the intellectual. Usually the biorhythm technology only speaks of three cycles: physical, mental, and emotional. Every individual goes through the cycles and they are related to the movement of the moon. The first physical cycle, which is very apparent during that time, it is more associated with women or associated with the menstrual cycle. But just as women have the menstrual cycle, men do have, but it does not have an apparent sign in case of male. But what is the side effects that particular cycle brings on an individual, that remains the same both in man and a woman, or a male and a female. The negativities breeds in, and that is the reason one is allowed to remain in a solitude and not to enter into any kind of activities. You would have observed that this cycle takes 28 days to complete. The next cycle takes 33 to 35 days, that is the mental cycle. You will realize that at a particular point in time, like say today, you realize that your energy is low, the thoughts are not flowing as it's supposed to be, but we are not aware of it. We do not know what is this happening. I was able to make the decisions very quick, but at this time it is not possible for me to do. So you are in that cycle. Sometimes it happens that the three cycles overlap or coincide with one another. That time one's energy is very, very high. When one is inflicted by one of these cycles, but these are the three only cycles which has been mentioned by the biorhythm technology, but each psychocenter, each has its own cycle. So you can say that there, at each stage one goes through this cycle. We have to monitor their ways and overcome these, so we are not affected by this and our consciousness moves ever these rhythm, biorhythm cycles. Then you transcend beyond the dualities of these cycles. So then there is no upheaval. Holy Prophet have said, there is none among you in whom there is not a devil. The devil represents the dualistic nature. Everyone goes through that dualistic nature. It is up to you to overcome this. At the stage of the physical, when you are going through the physical cycle, the dualistic nature remains, when you are going through, because you are affected by these cycles, affected by these dualistic natures at each stage. But when you consciously, through your own effort, move beyond the duality, which is now in a simple terminology which I had explained, that the first two, and there are seven basically known centers through which the energy moves in every seeker. Now the first center, earth center and water center, these are the two basic elements of which our body is composed of. And these two centers have to merge into one another. And with that, you are transcending the physical cycle. The physical cycle, then all those negativities that are associated with this physical cycle or the menstrual cycle, as we know in the medical terminology, you transcend that. The negative effect of that will not filter into your actions. Then along with that, the emotional centers, that is known as the fire center and the heart center, when the energy is moving between these two centers, are the second stage of nafs, then again the duality comes in. And to transcend these, you are to hammer those centers or use the techniques related to those centers. In subsequent sessions, I will take a particular technique of meditation to transcend beyond all these stages, and maybe when I am visiting you all next time, we will use this session of the meditation where we can incorporate the physical, the emotional and the mental, all the cycles together to transcend beyond that. So the second stage where the two centers have to, the energy has to flow equally in the two centers, and you transcend. When the energy begins to level in the two centers, that is the point you transcend. Transcend beyond that level and you are not inflicted. And it happens once you have reached to the higher standard, like for instance, you are a student of second of standard one. You have not yet passed out of that standard. When you passed out of that standard, any kind of a problem that arises at that level, you can you have transcended, you have gone beyond that. Only then and then you will be able to assist when you reach cross the standard one and reach to the standard two or standard three. Then you will be able to assist the students who are at this level or standard one and along with their problems, because you have transcended beyond that, your level have changed, and then you can sort out. Sometimes it happens, like for instance, you are going through your laptop or some problem arises and you are not able to overcome that. You go to someone who has at a higher level of understanding, and he will be able to sort out the problem automatically. If you want to know someone who has mastered a particular technique, like for instance the Adobe Audition, which is the system of recording, you can guide that person without him being present in front of you. But if you are not, then you will not, if you have not transcended or attained mastery over it, you will not be able to give the instructions to the other. So when an individual reaches at the emotional level, he has transcended the physical plane, which is the earth and the water center have merged into one another, and the energy begins to flow between these two centers freely. Then you will be able to explain the problem that arises at that level. Now this is what I am explaining to you, and when I am explaining, you can go into yes, this is what I used to face. But because my energy has transcended, it's not stuck in any of these centers, I can give you, speak to you something which is of the beyond, the dimensions beyond the known. Up to here, it was known about the sex. You have known only one aspect of sex, how to enter into the act of sex. But what happens when you are entering in an unconscious way, and when you are entering into a conscious way, then you will be able to help the seekers. So this is why it is transcending. Once you transcend, then you cannot go back to that state. Those problems will not inflict you anymore, which are basically were the parts at that time, part and parcel of that particular stage. The same way the duality continues to remain, and you remain inflicted by that duality when you reach the second stage, the stage of emotions, where the fire center and the heart center has to merge into one another. A bridge has, and consciousness creates a bridge between these two centers. Energy begins to move from one to the other. And it is, if there is no bridge and there is a gap, you will not be able to reach to the other shore. In order for you to reach to the other shore, you have to create the bridge, and then when you have created the bridge, you can walk over from one side to the other. From the earth, you can move to the water when the bridge is created. As the energy begins to move, a bridge is created, a passage is created, and through that passage, you can transcend, or you can wade through that from one shore to the other without any problem. Now, after that, the center of the expression, the throat center and the third eye center, which is the center where your consciousness dwells, from there you operate to go to the various stages. And this is where, from this center, this in yoga terminology is known as the center of command or agya. Instructions are given from this, how to operate at the physical plane. Then the master knows, he recognizes that you are operating at the physical plane, and he instructs you what to do at the physical plane, how to transcend beyond that. So the energy, the whatever you have experienced, you are able to communicate. But if the experience has not been there and you have simply read something somewhere, and in the absence of experience, you are simply begin to narrate, it will not have the influence. So only one, it is something like this. You want to reach to a particular destination. You have the GPS system in your hand. You enter the data into the GPS system and it will guide you automatically how to reach to that center. If you are not aware of the way and you have do not have the GPS system, then a journey alone becomes very difficult. You can get wayward at any stage. You can go into this lane or that lane. Where you see the attraction and you see a slight light you can move into, and the journey becomes difficult. So when you know the, if somebody is going, like you know the entire city very well, you know all the directions, and whichever direction or whichever area you have not been, but you have a GPS system which guides you in the moments when you are wavering and or you find that you have lost your way. So master is that GPS system that clearly gives you the indication, in order to reach from here to there you have to go through this. And if sometimes by mistake, although you are using the GPS system and you enter into, you miss one exit, it recalculates without being angry. The GPS system does not get angry or says that I had told you to go in that direction and you missed that road.
So it says wait, and it is recalculating the route and the time that you will take to reach to that place. The same thing happens, and you can say this is the compassion of GPS system, that it does not get angry because it knows the ways and means. The master knows the ways and means. The master knows the attraction of each stage, the physical, the emotional, and the other aspects. So he knows that the seeker can get deviated from the path, and when it does happen, through his compassion, through his love, he pulls you back into the fold, and he says that, there, let me recalculate that, and gives you another technique to come back to that fold. This is how the journey continues. So emphasis is, when you are in the world, you have to live into the world. You have to be married, you have to have a family, you have a children, you have to make your living so that you can provide the sustenance for family. Family here means people who are connected by a common bond. The children who are connected to one another through the bond of the blood, connected through the one parents. That is what we know as the basic sociological definition of the family. Then there is an extended family, the other family members are part of that. Then the hanka, where the people from the different parts, they come and become the part of that greater family. This is also an aspect of family, and everybody's needs are taken care of. So for that, we had to operate at the physical plane, but our goal is different. My goal is to attain to oneness with that which is, to reach to the realm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or attain the stage when a seed begins its journey, it wants to attain to fruition, where it becomes a flower. And when it becomes a flower, its petals fall and provide the manure for the subsequent generation of the plants or subsequent flowers that may blossom on that tree. And it also gives the leaves, the seeds behind, so that the process of this flowering or blossoming continues. This is your objective. So along with that, there is no harm living according to one's standards. But you do not forget at any time that my objective is not the physical plane or the emotional plane or this or that. And so everything that I am doing into the world is to attain that union or fana or merger with that which is. So with that intention, the journey continues. So marriage is an important aspect. And now, attaining the fulfillment in the marriage at the physical level. Otherwise, there remains many type of problems if the physical fulfillment is not given. It does not matter whether you follow the life of an ascetic, whether you follow the life of in any form, your commitment is at that level as well. You have knowingly and willingly entered into this marital relation with that person, fulfilling the physical needs and the emotional needs of the person is very important. So there should not be an ego or anything inflicting in fulfillment of that responsibility or that needs of that. And once you are able to understand your own emotional needs, you will be able to understand the emotional needs of the others. But if you do not, if you have not understood the yourself, how can you know the other? So this is why the one of the hadith says that man arfa nafsahu arfa nabbahu. One who has known himself, only he can know the truth. If you had known
or mastered your own emotions, then you can understand the emotions of the others. You can understand, you have gone through these stages, you can understand the stages, at what stage the person is now, and you can help or assist the other along the path. And this is the way the spiritual journey continues.